Well, plans for Brisbane's 2032 Olympics have taken a dramatic shift after Queensland Premier Stephen Miles rejected recommendations for a new stadium, ignoring a review he ordered.
Now, the Premier is denying reports he sought advice to cancel the Games altogether. So what will Brisbane 2032 look like going forward? Joining us now for more is President of Brisbane 2032 Organising Committee, Andrew Liveris, in Melbourne. Andrew, good of you to join us. Now, were you informed of the Premier's decisions before they were announced? This is a bit of a mess.
Well, hi, Sarah. I'm in your hometown. Melbourne's great. And Carl, hello to you. I've obviously been very close to the 60-day review process the last many weeks, and clearly Graham Quirk and the team have done a phenomenal job. And I just want to point out that the recommendations, 30 in total, 27 were accepted. And in terms of back and forth with us, the organising committee, it's been pretty seamless. We have been getting all the information we need to understand why decisions were made, when they were made, and actually, frankly, the cooperation that I've noticed in the last 18 months to put on the world's greatest event in the city of Brisbane, the region of Southeast Queensland and Queensland as a whole, has been tremendous. It's been great, very collaborative. Expect the unexpected is the way my mindset is around all of this. Casey Wasserman was on the SportsX NXT program that I'm on today here down in Melbourne, and he made the same comment about LA, and Paris has gone through the same process. So look, honestly, I think this has been a timely review, and we're going to get on with the Games. That's the mantra we have.
And that's what we all want, though. But is this the right decision, Andrew?
Well, look, the obviously the flashpoint of any big event, and in the particular the Olympic Games, is, you know, the main stadium, you know, the big events, particular, which is a centerpiece of Games delivery. We are going to have to deliver a cost neutral to the taxpayer game. So that's the mantra and what we've committed, not only to the IOC, but of course to the state of Queensland and the federal government. And the decisions around venues are all about legacy and all about what actually the region needs as a fast growing region. Those decisions are the domain of the people who are paying for them, which is the taxpayer, therefore the state and the federal government. We will just fit the games to the region, and whatever the outcome is, we will do with our partners the due diligence to make sure that the costs and the timelines are not affected. And I'm not going to opine on this or that. That's not our job. Our job is to put on the games with the venues we have. Remember, we won these games. We were committed to 85% of the venues either being in place or temporary. That's the new norms of the Olympics.
I understand.
And we are indeed the smallest place to ever put these games on. So it's very important that we fit what the state wants and what the government wants.
I guess if anyone out there is looking for criticism of the decisions, they're not going to get it from you. It's a very difficult place that you are in, and I'm fully aware of that, having been to Olympics headquarters, and you will roll with the punches. But I think some of these punches are pretty significant. And when you're talking about a Games in 2032, it's not that far away. And I don't think there's anything legacy about revamping QE2. But anyway, I know you can't talk about that, but let's roll on. Earlier, importantly, we spoke to Olympic gold medalist Kate Campbell. This is what she had to say.
And I think that we are really squandering an incredible opportunity by all this bickering, by short-term visions, by the government looking for ways to keep themselves in a job as opposed to what will actually be good for Southeast Queensland in the future.
So again, these criticisms mount on the sidelines. How do you possibly move forward when you don't really know, it's not confirmed, how it's going to look at this point?
Yeah, look, I feel for people who look at a vision and say 10 years out, in our case, 8 years out, we should have that for our region. We're a great sporting nation. We have great sporting champions, and we have won gold medals. We punch above our weight. But clearly, this is not for the Olympics. I've got to keep repeating that. When I accepted this job, the new norms, in fact, we're new, and we won the games on that basis. Otherwise, a small region like us and a small city like us can't possibly afford games if the whole new stuff that gets built has to be put on the cost of the games. I think what's important is this a legacy that the state of Queensland and Southeast Queensland want? And that's up to the elected politicians to decide, working with this now new independent authority. And look, I know people are going to not like decisions. Actually, frankly, something like this, once in a lifetime, you're going to have these perturbations. You mentioned that already. So I'm not perturbed about this or that. I think what we've got to do is get on with the costs analysis, the due diligence, the timelines, and then fulfil our commitments against delivering the best and biggest event on earth in our part of the world. That's the message we have as an organising committee.
Well, exactly, and we shouldn't forget that we are on the global stage.
Well, let me take you back to a moment of sheer exhilaration, a moment when a state came of age, when we trumpeted to the world, Queensland has arrived, and we duly celebrated. Remember this?
That the games of the 35th Olympiad are awarded to Brisbane, Australia.
Well, we were on top of the world. All the emotions, tears and cheers could have been for nothing, with claims that the Queensland government sought advice and even considered cancelling the Brisbane 2032 Olympic Games. Queensland State political editor Tim Arvia broke the story last night and joins us live along with Olympian Kate Campbell. Good morning, guys. Nice to see you. Tim, to you first up. The Premier's office has denied these claims. I know who I believe.
Yeah, I had a bit of a chuckle last night when I saw that, actually, and it came out that they said that, no, they did not consider this. But, look, I already note that other media is saying today that senior figures within the government have raised the question about cancelling the Games. I can tell you one reason, maybe, that there was a denial from the Premier's office last night, and that was because the people preparing the media responses didn't know that this advice was sought. So let me tell you how it all happened. This all happened less than 48 hours ago on Monday. Advice was sought as to whether the Games could be cancelled and what the cost would be for that. That advice was taken to Cabinet, and the advice that was taken to Cabinet was it would cost at least $500 million, potentially even more, maybe even up to $1 billion, to get out of hosting the Games with cancellation. Now, there was also advice that it would also there would be about $3 billion of federal funding withdrawn. That is the advice that was taken to Cabinet. All 19 or 18 ministers plus the Premier were briefed on that, except for the Police Minister Mark Ryan, who wasn't there, he was off sick. That was all discussed, it was considered at Cabinet, and ultimately they made the call to not go ahead with any cancellation of the Games and to press ahead with hosting it and to press ahead with that option. That decision was based upon the cancellation fees, the damage to Queensland's reputation, if they had cancelled it, and ultimately they made the call. Now, because it is Cabinet discussions, they won't come out and publicly say, oh yes, this did happen, but I tell you what, the one thing they won't be doing is denying that these discussions took place, and I look forward to Parliament. It's on today. Lying to Parliament's a pretty serious deal, so I really look forward to seeing if any politicians, any ministers get up there and deny it happened.
Well, the thing is, we don't want to do an Olympic Games light. And the story came from within his government. That's what he's doing now. So he's got dramas inside his own government and even bigger ones outside now.
Yeah, look, I mean, a lot of this also stems back to the by-elections we just saw on the weekend. You know, it's a massive loss there, and that now the government has to try to win an election 7 months after suffering swings of around 20% of by-elections. Trying to do that's like trying to put a toddler down for a nap after giving it a few coffees. It's really, really hard. So it's no surprise that everything's on the table here, especially the Olympics, because the Olympics now, the brand of the Olympics has gone down in Queensland. It's almost toxic. Even the government's own polling earlier this year showed only 38% of Queenslanders support it now, and that was before all this stadium fiasco. So you can only wonder what the support levels are like now. So is it any surprise in a cost of living crisis the government has looked at doing what Dan Andrews did and cancelling the Games? Now, it was considered at Cabinet, but ultimately they decided not to go ahead.
All right. Thank you, Timmy. Let's see what happens today. Kate, to you now. Look, I was so genuinely excited about the Olympics. It's the biggest event that will happen in this country for a long, long time since Sydney. Brisbane's ye olde QE2 stadium will be the smallest athletics venue in more than 100 years. It's embarrassing, but I genuinely feel so much for the athletes here as well.
Yeah, I just think that this is a case of politics getting in the way of progress. We thought that we had, you know, nearly a 4-year head start to prepare and get ready for these games, and it's just been squandered time and time again. I mean, this review cost $450,000, and I know that the state premier is talking about cost of living and not wanting to spend things, but you've just spent $450,000 on a review when you had a perfectly good action plan. I think first and foremost, it's reassuring for the athletes that the games are going ahead, but I think it's disappointing to see so much negative rhetoric around it. And let's not forget that one of the most watched events in Australian history was Cathy Freeman at the 2000 Olympic Games. That was only topped by the Matildas win over France. And so it really shows the power of sport in uniting Australia. And I think that we are really squandering an incredible opportunity by all this bickering, by short-term visions, by the government looking for ways to keep themselves in a job as opposed to what will actually be good for Southeast Queensland in the future.
100%. I mean, the Olympics is the event and they're ballsing it up completely. What happens if it goes ahead the way that they're planning now? Because as an athlete, you just got to get on with it. But it's got to be a showcase.
It has to be a showcase. And Sydney, the Sydney Olympics put Sydney on the world map. It took Sydney from being a cute little city down in a country that not many people had heard of, where everyone thought that we had kangaroo had as pets, and it took us to the world stage. Sydney is now one of the most iconic destinations in the world, and the Sydney Olympics did a massive job in boosting that. And we already know that after the Brisbane 2032 Olympics were announced, Googling of Brisbane as a city went up by 1,500%. And that was just after the announcement. Can you imagine in the years leading into the Brisbane 2032 Olympics, if you look at the next cities that are hosting the Olympic Games, they are Paris and they are LA. They are two global cities. And now we can include Brisbane in that. But we need them to stack up against what Paris are going to do, and we know it's going to be spectacular, and what LA are already planning. And from looking at the plans, they're already thinking ahead. They're future focused. They're looking at things, you know, like can they use Uber helicopters to help get spectators out to events. Not only that, but we're missing a real opportunity to build infrastructure in Queensland, 100%. In Brisbane, in Southeast Queensland. So much of Sydney's infrastructure, their rail infrastructure, was built to accommodate the Sydney Olympic Games. We wouldn't have a rail line out to the western suburbs. We wouldn't have a train line out to the Sydney airport without those Sydney Games. And we are missing that opportunity. We've had Taylor Swift say that, no, she's not coming to Queensland because there's not enough stadiums to host her. And we have Coldplay going to Perth because they have more venues than Southeast Queensland does. And it's just simply not good enough. Mm. We have an opportunity to put Brisbane on the world stage, both for sporting events, but also international entertainment events. And this is a real legacy opportunity that I think is being missed because politicians are short-sighted and thinking of their own personal gains rather than what is best for Southeast Queensland.
Right on, Kate Campbell. You want to run for Premier?
I've got a few things I need to finish up first.
I understand, but when you're done, we're ready for you. What a legend. Temavia, keep digging. Thanks for it. To that shock revelation revealed exclusively by Nine News, the Queensland government considered axing the 2032 Brisbane Games. The Miles government hitting back, saying they never intended to cancel the Games.
Today, Queensland reporter Andrea Crothers has the latest for us. Andrea, either way, frustrations are certainly growing.
Yeah, guys, but it was almost game over for Brisbane 2032. But that move, the advice saying it would have actually cost Queensland $500 million to cancel the games in compensation, plus lose $3 billion from federal funding. Now, the Premier's office denies they ever considered cancelling the games, insisting that they were always committed to completing them. Premier Stephen Miles has been doubling down on his decision to ignore advice from an independent review he ordered that said that we should build a new stadium. The state opposition also hasn't revealed what it would do should it come to power after the state election later this year. Meanwhile, guys, it could be harder than ever for Queenslanders to actually get tickets to see the games because CUSAC, if used, will be the smallest venue in more than a century of the event.
It's embarrassing. Andrew, thank you. Let's go to today's Jack Hahn in Sydney now. Jack, if Queensland want to dump it, Sydney's ready to snap it up.
That's sure right, Carl. Good morning to you. The general sentiment seems to be if it's going to be Queensland's trash, we'll take it as treasure. Many people excited by the remote prospect, or at least the conversation of another Olympic Games being held in the Harbour City 32 years after the year 2000. One of the state's top politicians, our treasurer, Daniel Mookie, has even weighed in on the saga, making some very public pot shots at his Labor counterparts in Queensland, saying that the Sunshine State has a very high standard to meet that was set by Sydney in the year 2000, and is going as far as to say that if they can't get there, they should call New South Wales. Here is how Sydneysiders are reacting to the news this morning.
We did it once, do it again. And I think the atmosphere would be crazy in Sydney too. I mean, bless Queensland, but Sydney's Sydney.
Sydney gets around everything.
Yes, so, they do.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah, do you reckon we would do a better job than Queensland?
Yeah, for sure. Haven't we done it before? Or am I?
Well, Carl, it would seem even this saga has turned into a little bit of State of Origin rivalry.
Yeah, I see what you're doing, Jack. Thank you, mate.
I like it.